On TikTok, there is a dog named Noodle. Now, each day, Noodle either wakes up with bones, as seen here, where he has enough strength to stand, or with no bones, where he flops back down onto the bed. Noodle has become kind of a guiding force for the daily mood of the internet. On a bones day, people are encouraged to get out of bed and make the most of their day, maybe take a risk or try something new, whereas a no bones day might be the time to take it easy and think a little bit about self-care. So what does this have to do with quantum computing? Well, almost nothing. But I did notice that the chance of a bones to a no bones day does seem to be about 50-50. That's the same chance that a qubit in an even superposition of states 0 and 1 would have of being measured in either state. I recently found out that quantum computing is actually further ahead than where I thought it was, and in fact right now anyone can submit code to be run on a real quantum computer. So to figure out how to do that, I set out to ask a real quantum computer, bones or no bones? The answer might come from some point of deep intrinsic truth about our universe, or maybe it's just pretty close to truly random. This video is sponsored by Qiskit, which is IBM's open source quantum computing software. With Qiskit, we can use the Python coding language to actually program circuits and algorithms for a quantum computer. IBM also give access to the hardware, having already built quite a few quantum computers. These are currently only relatively small and used for experimental purposes. IBM recently unveiled their largest one to have 127 qubits, but we're still a way off from these quantum systems being large enough to outperform the classical computers. IBM have made their smaller 5-qubit quantum computers free for anyone to use. You just have to submit your code through the IBM Quantum Lab. But before I could run my little experiment, I first had to learn just enough about qubits, quantum circuits, and programming with Qiskit to actually write my program, and I'll quickly fill you in on what I've learned. Alright, so it's important to know what we're dealing with here. In classical computing, information is stored using bits, and these can either be 0 or 1. They're binary, and they're like tiny little switches. Now, bits all act independently of each other, and we can manipulate bits using logic gates. There are quite a few different kinds of logic gates, but for example, one of them is the NOT gate. The NOT gate can be drawn like this, and it would turn a 0 into a 1, or a 1 into a 0. Now, when we're dealing with quantum computing, we're dealing with something called the qubit, and these are just quantum bits. We can represent qubits as an arrow pointing on the surface of a sphere. We'll see if I can draw a sphere in here. I'll actually draw a couple. Alright, so if we have, say, an arrow pointing on our sphere, and if that arrow is pointing straight up, well, that qubit would be in the zero state. And if the arrow was pointing straight down, then that qubit would be in the one state. But the arrow can also point anywhere else on the sphere. Our arrow could point to the side like this, and this qubit is in a superposition of the zero and one states. Now, when you measure a qubit, you do still only get out a 0 or a 1 as the result, and that's because measurement collapses the superposition. If you were to keep measuring the same qubit again and again, you would get the same result. It is only before measurement takes place that a qubit is able to exist in multiple states at once, which gives it the ability to do things that classical bits can't. That means if you've got a program that's working with qubits, you'll try to keep measurement to the last step in the process. If we were to measure this superposition here, we would find that because the arrow is pointing halfway between the 0 and 1, that there would be a 50% chance of returning a 0 upon measurement and a 50% chance of getting a 1. If instead the arrow had been pointing maybe more towards the 0, that might have given an 80% chance of a 0, 20% chance of 1. And likewise down here, this arrow might have given 80% chance of a 1, 20% chance of a 0. But physically, how do you make a qubit? Well, there are actually several types. It's just any two-state quantum system, such as the spin of an electron or the polarization of a single photon. IBM uses superconducting transmon qubits, which are a superconducting material on a silicon chip, arranged so that there is an artificial atom with quantized energy levels, and then kept extremely cold in a ground state of 0. Radiation can be applied to excite the qubit to the 1 state, or to enter a superposition. I spent some time on the Qiskit online textbook, learning the absolute basics, and I'm pretty happy that I've managed to get some working code. I've just written it on the IBM Quantum Lab server, so you don't even need to download anything if you don't want to. My code starts with importing everything we need, and then I also got it to print a list of the available hardware that I can run the code on. It lists the 5-qubit quantum computers I can use, as well as some simulators, which make more sense when you're just testing the code. This little code here is setting up my circuit. It's actually fairly simple, and there's a diagram here of what's going on. Q is my 1-qubit, and all qubits start initialized at 0, which is their ground state. But I want it to be in a 50-50 superposition, so I've applied a quantum logic gate. That is the H symbol here. It is the Adamar gate. Now, when it comes to quantum logic gates, there are some that are similar to their classical counterparts. For example, there is a quantum NOT gate, and it's represented as an X. Like the classical NOT gate that we looked at, this one has the ability to turn a 0 into a 1, or a 1 into a 0. It essentially flips the sign. And we can even see how this is represented physically with our sphere. If inside our sphere we set up some axes, so maybe a Y there, an X, and up and down to be Z, then you can actually see where the quantum NOT gate gets its symbol, the X, from. It actually flips the arrow over the X axis. So if we had a qubit that was, say, a 0, meaning that the arrow was pointing straight up, then if it was to be flipped across the X axis, it would come out looking like a 1. Likewise, there are some quantum logic gates called Y and Z that flip it over those axes too. But the H gate that we want to use in our circuit is kind of unique to the quantum world. After passing through an H gate, a qubit that started as 0 will have a 50% chance of being 0 and a 50% chance of being 1. But the H gate isn't just a randomizer. For example, if you were to pass a qubit through 2 H gates, one after the other, it would basically undo the effect and you would get back whatever value you started with. And that's not behavior you would expect from something that's just randomizing the results. Something else is going on here. What the H gate is actually doing is applying a rotation around the line between the X and the Z axes, so this line in here. Now you might be able to see that if an arrow had been pointing straight up, representing 0, then flipping it over this line would put it here, halfway between 0 and 1, meaning it has 50% chance of being measured as 0 and 50% chance of being measured as 1. Then, if you were here and you did another rotation back around the same axes, so you applied your second age gate, well, you would actually end up back where you started, back at zero. And so you can see why two age gates do undo the effect. The last component in my circuit is a measurement to collapse the superposition. I'm first going to run the code on the simulator. I've set shots equal to 1, which means we're going to run this one time, and we'll get one result out of our qubit. It'll either be a 0, and in that case it'll be a no bones day, or we'll get a 1, which will be a bones day. So running this now, it prints out that the result 1 was obtained one time, and that makes it a bones day. Running it again, we see that 0 was now returned as the result. But let's increase the number of shots so that we have more than one result. I can increase it to 100. This time it says that the result 1 was returned 45 times and 0 was returned 55 times. So we're getting close to a 50-50 split, but we're not quite there yet. And just to see what happens, let's go for 100,000 shots. Alright, getting even closer to 50-50 here. I think we can be pretty confident that this code is getting us into that superposition that we want. Now I think we're ready to run it on the real quantum computer. We can come onto the quantum lab dashboard and see all of the quantum computers and whether they're online and what their queues look like. We will need to join the end of the queue for whatever job we want to run, so hopefully we can find something where the queue is pretty short. These are actually their large machines, the 127 qubit one up there in Washington. But we're going to want to use the smaller 5-qubit machines. In fact, what we're doing only needs 1 qubit, really. Looking here, the machine in Bogota has the smallest queue with only 7 pending jobs. So what we'll do is we'll copy that name, take it to our code, and tell it that that's the backend we wish to use. Let's just do it with one shot because we want to find out what kind of day we're going to have. And if we run this, it will send it off to the quantum computer. I can check up on it in this tab here, which are all the jobs that I've sent. It says an estimated time of 2 minutes till completion, but for you after the edit, that might be a lot shorter. And we've got our result. It's a bones day. It took 2 minutes and 21 seconds to get the result. You can see here it says that a 1 was measured with 100% probability, and my code returned that it is a bones day. That's wonderful news for all. Do something amazing. Go learn quantum computing. Maybe work on that side project or write some New Year's Eve resolutions. Just so you know, whenever this video reaches you is when your bones day applies. So even if you're watching this in the future, it applies to you too. We can send another request off with more shots, maybe try 10,000 this time, just to check our distributions. When running things on these real quantum computers, noise is also something that you usually have to take into account. I think for us, since this is so simple and just with 1 qubit, doesn't really apply. But more complicated programs would really have to consider noise in their results. Our result is in 6 minutes 39 seconds to say that 0 was returned 53% of the time, 1 46% of the time. Mine is a pretty trivial use, but there are lots more of those more complicated algorithms on Qiskit that you can use and that actually take advantage of the quantum abilities. For me, this is just a really cool way to learn, but it can also be practical if you're actually wanting a career somewhere in quantum computing. Here is a current active job listing from IBM Quantum. It's for a Qiskit researcher. You can see some of the responsibilities here. It may be no surprise to see that in required experience, they want you to have done some research projects already using Qiskit. They also want you to have working knowledge of quantum computing and at least a master's degree. If working on quantum computers in this kind of way is something you think you'd like to do, then learning something like Qiskit is really going to help you get there. Make the most of your bones day. Maybe commit to learning a skill like this or applying for a new job. Thanks for watching this video, and thanks to my Patreon supporters. A special thanks to today's Patreon cats of the day, Stinky and Sprinkles.